In the jungle, Sorin in the mid lane, Woolite the AD carry, and Unlimited on support.
And on the red side, it is SK Gaming. Freddy is playing top, Sven Skeren in the jungle, Jez is in the mid lane with Candy Panda AD carry, and Enrated in the support role.
So let's check in then and see how you guys predicted this match will play out. According to the votes on lolesports.com, SK has 72% of you rooting for them. Hard to argue with that, even though SK Gaming are on maybe a bit of a downward spiral, you could say. They own the head-to-head record in this matchup specifically. They've played three times, SK won them all.
Yeah, this is actually going to be a very important game for the Wolves. If they want to hold on to any chances of making playoffs, they need to win the rest of their games. They also need their opponents to lose to multiple teams. So this is what we touched on in the schedule, or the standings rather. It's not mathematically impossible, it is just unlikely. Also, it needs to be a big confidence boost for the Wolves. They've not taken a game off SK, and SK have not looked at their strongest. So if the Wolves can start with SK and then aim higher on the table, that's how they can get the momentum working in their favor.
Yeah, definitely a good team to, I think, be facing in this scenario for them. One of the easier opponents that they have in the league, especially with the likes of Fnatic now really stepping up there. A lot of work to be done for SK, that's for sure.
Yeah, we'll have to see how they focus picks and bans. Yesterday, Sven Skeren played Jarvan in the jungle because of the emphasis on jungle bans, and he had little to no impact. And Sven's a player that I keep looking at to say he needs to step up to help his team get control.
So here we go then, into the bans and picks between the Copenhagen Wolves and SK Gaming. And coming in pretty quickly here, no real surprises. Aatrox banned against Freddy. Redside Kassadin ban coming out there as well. Also taking Fizz away from Jezzus.
So Fizz is a champion that is definitely rising to popularity. I also want to highlight that yesterday we've seen a fair few Xerath's being played, and it was used just earlier today in the quarterfinals over in OGN. So, you know, that mid lane is shifting, it is changing. We're seeing Syndra, we're seeing Nidalee, we're seeing some different champions being played, and there's a lot of mid lane champions taking off the table so far.
Well, we're not seeing Nidalee played here today because that will be banned out. We saw Freddy, of course, running that one yesterday for SK Gaming. And on the other side, Twisted Fate also removed. So far, as you mentioned, quite a lot of emphasis on that mid lane.
Copenhagen Wolves are deciding to try shut down Freddy. This means, with both Nidalee and Aatrox off the table, Youngbuck may consider playing Renekton. I take that back, because SK have actually taken that off the table as well. Irelia is still up and available. You've got all of the junglers still up and available, as is Lucian. Remember, this is 4.11, so this is prior to the changes that are on live. Lucian is still very, very strong, and definitely a heavy favorite for the majority of LCS teams.
And imagining that we're going to be seeing a Gragas coming out of this one. We've seen him top lane multiple times, even a couple of mid lane runs as well from numerous teams. Copenhagen Wolves, though, may have been a little thrown off by that final Renekton ban. And there is the Gragas, first pick for the Wolves.
Yeah, so yesterday, Gragas was open for SK Gaming, and they did not run it. And it was against Millennium. So they decided to go for that sort of bruisery style, the mobility. I want to see how Youngbuck's going to decide to itemize. Soaz played Gragas yesterday. He ended up going full tank. He just rushed a Sunfire Cape as his first item. We've seen Lich Bane first. We've seen AP heavy builds. And it's just going to depend what the rest of the Wolves build around this Gragas, what role he needs to fill.
Just to see what Freddy is going to go with in this top lane. Lucian seems like a pretty obvious choice here in SK Gaming's first round of picks. Looks like they may aim for the jungle as well. Svenskeren going to get back onto Evelynn, something that maybe was somewhat missing for him yesterday. In fact, SK Gaming themselves banned out Evelynn against Millennium.
Yeah, they did. And Millennium took Lee Sin off the table. They locked in Elise early, which meant Svenskeren didn't get one of those sort of trifecta junglers that we like to talk about. The Lucian lock in early for Candy Panda, I think, is quite smart, because it's one of his most played champions. He's got 6 games already played. He's also denying it from Woolite, so it's going to give him the option and the versatility to throw that champion in any of the lanes. It also allows SK, if they want to go for a sort of a pick or a dive heavy style of play with the Evelynn, it's going to work in their favor.
So Braum, Orianna, the choices for the Copenhagen Wolves. Safe mid lane pick here for Sorin. And we've seen how Unlimited has really shone in the last couple of weeks with that Braum. If you think back to the Alliance game where they basically crushed them very quickly and very convincingly, it was Unlimited who was just roaming the entire time with Braum.
Yeah, but the one concern I have from what the Wolves have put together already is a heavy AoE somewhat press our comp. They're going to be very reliant on Soren hitting his shockwaves, very reliant on Unlimited getting good Glacial Fishes. Yes, there's room for error. If they make a mistake, Gragas can knock people away, but you already got the makings of a very strong team fight, dare I say, wombo combo, team composition. If they want to throw something like a Rengar in the jungle or a Twitch onto a Warlight, they could also use a very strong pick composition. We've seen the Rengar-Orianna combinations from last week in NA, if I serve correctly, remember correctly, doing very, very well. But of course, with Lee Sin and Lee Sap, we're probably not going to see that.
Well, we do see the SK Gaming are going to Xerath, the champion that's really shot to popularity, really. Had four games. This will be the fifth game played, 75% win rate up until now. And also take Shyvana for Freddy in that top lane. More of his older style with that Shyvana.
Yeah, definitely going back to also a split push style of champion. Yesterday, the Fisher was talking about how if SK have wave clear on Candy Panda or Jezzes, and they can have a split pushing champion for Freddy, that tends to be how they create opportunities. They have a one champion in the side lane, and the rest of the team grouped up as a four man. The nice thing about having Sven Skjern on Evelynn with that style of play is he can help Freddy set up kills if he's split pushing, as well as working well with the four-man team to create those flanks. SK are going to be very interested in getting side lane vision to make sure that Shyvana and Evelynn can both flank while Jezzes is wave clearing in the lane.
Well, the Copenhagen Wolves going to be putting Tristana into effect, taking Jarvan here as well then. So different champion coming out for Broken Shard here today. Of course, yesterday actually ran Elise in the jungle in their loss to Fnatic. And Warlight again showing that he really favors these late game hyper carries.
Yeah, it's gonna be very interesting to see how they play around this Jarvan, because Elise was up, Lee Sin was up. And with those champions being available, Broken Shard has voluntarily opted to run Jarvan the fourth. It does continue to play into the sort of AoE heavy style. There is so much zone control. The ball from Orianna, the Cataclysm from Jarvan, the knockback from Gragas, all of that added to the fact that Tristana herself can get rid of any threats that jump onto her, means in theory, Warlight should have all of the peel and all of the protection in the world. The trick for Copenhagen Wolves is to get to a point where Orianna is strong in the mid game and Tristana's got items in the late game that can then shred through Shyvana and Evelynn. If Warlight doesn't make it to a strong position, he's just going to get run down by both Evelynn and Shyvana from the sides, and if Copenhagen Wolves get split up, all of the power of AoE is completely mitigated.
I have to say, here in Europe, Orianna has been a very strong pick for a lot of these teams and has been allowed constantly to farm heavy. I mean, if you look at those CS records that Frog and Peke have been fighting over, they're all basically Orianna, getting a lot of time in there, able to farm up well. We'll see about it, but guys, which team do you think came out on top in Champions League? Tweet at LOL Esports with hashtag CWWin or hashtag SKWin. Get that one out. We'll see if these lineups manage to sway your votes, any.
Yeah, we'll have to see. I'm sitting on the hedge in terms of which team I feel has got the stronger champions, but I do think for Copenhagen Wolves, if they do get split up, that is a massive knock to their team fighting power. They are such a death ball. They want Orianna and Jarvan and Braum to be moving together as a unit, keeping Tristana between them and the enemies. On the other side of the coin, I think vision is also going to be very important, because if SK can have strong jungle wards down, it will give Sven Skjern and Freddy the chance to come in from the side lanes and mitigate that strength. So it's all going to be vision, it's all going to be timing on getting past that massive amount of AoE and massive amount of CC the Wolves have got on the table.
Well, let's find out. The Copenhagen Wolves versus SK Gaming is our first game of the day here, week 9 of the European LCS, and it's all getting very serious here as we move towards playoffs and even further towards Worlds, the big aim for most of these teams. The Wolves may have already had to adjust their priorities somewhat here and maybe think, okay, maybe it's not about Worlds, this split. Maybe it's about just surviving.
They have to be. I mean, the late change to their roster, Kautzard feeling the weight of playing for so long, basically forced him to step down. So that's why Soren's in the Copenhagen Wolves. They also made the decision to replace Airwax with Broken Shard because Kautzard was one of their callers. He was one of their in-game leaders. And Broken Shard is known for being a vocal player and an in-game leader. Yesterday, he accredited that very early Dragon call that I was talking about to Unlimited, saying that it was actually Unlimited saying, we can take Dragon, let's go for it. And we need to see how they handle themselves, because they were outclassed individually by Fnatic yesterday. But SK are far from playing at the same level that Fnatic is right now.
Totally agree with you on that one. And Youngwook will be hoping for a solid game today, because yesterday was pretty much just a disaster for him overall. Obviously giving up that first blood in the top lane to Reckless, which got the Avalanche really rolling there. Svenskeren coming in, gets a ward down in the Death Brush to spot out Broken Shard. The Copenhagen Wolves have been seen now. And there's a ward from Broken Shard into the red pit as well, but not too much deeper vision. I think that might force both of these teams to have more of a standard start, although we see Evelyn moving down towards the Wolves as red.
Yeah, we'll see if that's reactionary. Svenskeren may believe that the Copenhagen Wolves are going for a red buff invade, and he wants to try and sort of do the same thing, but obviously you can see there's no pressure or no assistance for Svenskeren. He is going to get spotted by this ward as he reveals himself in combat, and it doesn't look like Unlimited's moving. So, standard lanes for both of these teams. Finally, Unlimited's moving up, but got the support of Enraged and Candy Panda. Pretty good poke.
Yeah, little Flay coming in there. Unlimited blasted down to about half HP. We see now that Broken Shard, with that, has decided to cross over and go for the steal on the red. So, funnily enough, if Sven's going to just gone to do that red inside of the pit rather than bringing it out, I don't think that ward would have maybe spotted him fully. But now he's going to try and challenge here, Broken Shard, on that red buff. It's going to be close. Broken Shard, his smite's not quite up here. Svenskeren also doesn't have his smite available. There's the push in, and there is the red buff actually going over, and Broken Shard will just slide away.
Manages to get out cleanly. Svenskeren didn't have the support of either Jezzes or Freddy. If you were looking at the minimap, Freddy was being pushed closer towards his tower, and if maybe Jezzes had responded a tiny bit quicker, may have caught Broken Shard off guard. Look at Jezzes, it's flash and heal for his summoner spells. Sora on the other side, flash and heal as well. So no teleports, no exhausts, no ignites for those mid laners. Also slightly different to what we're seeing usually.
Pretty defensive, and I think what we're going to see there is a big farm game between Jezzes and Sora. We've already seen that Jezzes likes these farm-heavy champions as well. Very safe with the range that Xerath is going to offer him. It's kind of similar to the Syndra Xerath lane that we saw yesterday, where both players just sat almost back on their own tower and were farming it at range.
So I want to talk a tiny bit about the Xerath pick and why I think it's good, but we'll get to that after this. They've caught Unlimited.
Unlimited going to get hooked in there. It's Svenskeren showing himself. Unlimited takes a lot of damage here. Have they got enough to finish him off, though? One more hit spike will do it. And there is the first blood going over to SK Gaming.
And it's Svenskeren that manages to secure it. Sven is very important in helping SK get to the mid game in a strong position. And in the spring split earlier in the year, when he was playing Pantheon, he did it incredibly well. This is a good start for SK, as well as getting some control in that bottom lane. And even more importantly, if they can keep Woolite down, prevent Woolite hitting that late game power spike, I think that's going to be very important for the Wolves. So I do want to touch on the Xerath pick. With Exhaust being so much stronger against Assassins, and Assassin play basically falling out of favor, oh, it's very brave from Unrated. Get some poke down. We're noticing Xerath coming into play, and I think one of the reasons he does very well against champions like Syndra, who is currently the flavor of the last 2 or 3 weeks, been played very effectively. The long range, the poke, and the low cooldown on his ultimate basically means he's more of a sniper version than Ziggs in some ways. All right, Freddy's teleporting top. Svenskeren is going to come in behind Youngbuck, and he still has red buff available, so Youngbuck may be in a little bit of trouble.
Only level 3 though to the level 5 here, and Youngbuck actually coming out of lane, he's just going to be recalling from that one. We'll TP back up to that as his wave was pushed up on towards Freddy's turret anyway. And here's Svenskeren and Broken Shard just going to spot each other out as Svenskeren looping back around trying to steal a wolf camp. Now Youngbuck's even coming in as well. This could be dangerous for Svenskeren, but he's doing a lot of damage to Broken Shard. He's going to go down, but surely Svenskeren will be finished off here as well. It's Sorin that gets the kill back and gets the buffs.
So very, very easy 1v1. Svenskeren just melts Broken Shard in the jungle. If Broken Shard had had Elise or Lee Sin, that duel could have gone very differently. But because he had the Jarvan, obviously Svenskeren has the advantage in the battle. And that's arguably why Sven is maybe playing as aggressive as he is, challenging Broken Shard for the first red buff, invading him in the jungle. Fortunately, it does mean that he gives a kill over to Sorin in the mid lane. Jezzes is taking a lot of damage. Sorin also has got the blue buff now,
yeah,
thanks to that kill. And that's obviously going to help him out in this lane quite significantly.
a couple of problems maybe for Jezus in that front. Sorin actually did use his flash though, which means that his defensive capability is going down somewhat. Svenskeren looking like he was maybe going to have a bit of a dig at him there, but I think realizing as Orianna goes back and will be spotted out here by a pink ward, he needs to get out of there.
Yeah, we'll see. We'll see how Sven continues to play, because it's definite focus on counter jungling and aggression. He's going to have the support of Candy Fan and Razor, but it's late. He's caught.
There's a shockwave coming in as well. Svenskeren, though, flashes over the top of the Dragon Pit. As I said before, no flash for Sorin. Broken Shard uses flash to get that little fight started, and close to taking down Svenskeren, it's at least going to hinder his progress in terms of farming as he has to go back again.
Window of opportunity now for SK Gaming. Without flash on both Sorin and Broken Shard, they can punish, and Unlimited does get caught by the death sentence, but a strong unbreakable means he gets away cleanly. Notice Woolite has got himself a pickaxe. The only reason I highlight that, we've seen Tristana's, actually an OGN, as well as China, starting with a static shift, first item, trying to farm themselves and trying to get static shift infinity edge. What it ends up doing is it delays your first major item being the infinity edge, but it does mean you get to a two item static shift eye edge slightly sooner. So it may also signal Woolite wants to farm as long as possible if he goes that route. So I want to take a look. The alternative is, of course, that he just rushes an Infinity Edge, but we'll just see.
Some choice for him right now as well. Obviously, we did see Candy Panda go back, picked up the Vamp Scepter, so we'll see how much damage and how much of a trade-off Woolite will make in this bottom lane. Meanwhile, Broken Shard getting his own blue buff here after the first spawning of it was stolen away by Svenskeren. Svenskeren doing exactly the same over on his side of the map. And we see that SK in this bottom lane are starting to be pushed back a little.
Yeah, they are playing it a little safer. And they're happy to just keep farming up, because one of the things that plays into SK's favor is if Candy Panda goes for the Blade of the Ring King Ghost Blade build, he should have a stronger mid-game than Tristana's, because Tristana's going to need three or four items really before her range and her levels and her damage will be on the same level as that very strong duelist in Lucian. On the same token, if they can get Woolite some damage and then Copenhagen Wolves can force SK to group, they can use their team fighting power to overcome that strength that Candy Panda will have in the situation, because you see he's a tiny bit behind in CS. Woolite and Unlimited have done a fairly good job just getting a small advantage, but it's not exactly what you like.
Yeah, especially when you consider that Woolite had time on his own in that bottom lane because of that first blood that came onto Unlimited. Meanwhile, Jezus is going to finally get himself the blue buff, which will send him back off to lane. He's currently a tick behind in CS, but as the bottom lane, not exactly a massive amount at this stage. Trying to farm off the raid camp there is Sorin as well. Always a good way to make sure that you stay somewhat ahead in that one. They spotted Broken Shard coming in as well. Svenskeren will actually be here for a counter gank if Broken Shard goes for anything, but I think he's just backing away now.
Yeah, it doesn't look like they're trying to make any plays happen. In the bottom, they've pulled Woolite.
Oh, jump away though, and I think he might be safe from this one. Unbreakable was already up for Unlimited, and Woolite able to just jump away. Could have been very dangerous. Svenskeren was already on his way down, but just a little bit too late to the party though.
It's very confident, aggressive play from Enrated. Every time we take a look at that bottom lane, Enrated is getting in the faces of the Wolves, landing the auto attacks and the flays, and now Candy Panda's, you know, made up that single wave worth of minions, pushing the wave down. He's also got the backup of Svenskeren, so there should be some good damage onto the tower if they decide to stick around with the big minion wave. Opting to back instead, he's got 1700 gold as well, so Candy Panda gonna be spending some of that money and gonna pick up the Cutlass as well as two attack speed daggers. So definitely going for the Blade of the Ring King itemization, and that means that once they get that, SK should be looking to duel, SK should be looking to fight. For the time being, it's all of the engages have really been around Svenskeren counter jungling and getting in the face of Broken Shard.
I see that the Copenhagen Wolves, looks like it was them that called that pause up there, so hopefully that'll get sorted. But gives us a little bit of time to look over what we've got, especially since we're about to hit the 10-minute mark in the game. Slight gold lead for SK Gaming, 600, and they are 2-1 up in kills. No real tower pressure coming in as of yet. Neither of the teams deciding that it's time for a dragon, although you could argue that moment where the Wolves have been forced out of bottom lane could have opened them up for a bit of a dragon attempt.
Yeah, I agree, and I'm also even more interested to see Candy Panda and Enrated not go for any damage on the tower. They had about two minion waves worth of minions with him on the bottom lane, as well as the tank with them. And They opted to back, opted to spend some of the money. The extended laning phase, I think, is going to be very interesting because both of these teams scale fairly effectively. But what we have been noticing is just how Freddy has been sort of getting in the face of Young Buck in the top lane with Shyvana. It hasn't cost Young Buck any CS or any deaths at the moment, but Freddy has been playing very aggressively. So if he can get to a strong position and he can pull some attention and some aggro from the Copenhagen Wolves, that's going to allow Svenskeren and the rest of the team to create picks and to be more mobile in this mid-game.
Well, here we go then, back into the matchup. And just as we were talking about Dragon, look at this. The Copenhagen Wolves are forced back. SK used that opportunity to actually recall, and it's looking like it's going to cost them the first Dragon of the game.
Yeah, it's just good play from Copenhagen Wolves. Realizing the situation and taking the first objective of the game. One of the reasons SK may not have wanted that engage is in a team fight, SK Gaming, in a straight up, like, bashing heads will be weaker. The power of Gragas, the power of Jom, the power of Orianna in a straight up fight will always give them the advantage. But in the flanking maneuvers, if SK can catch the Wolves off guard, that is when Shyvana and Evelynn can do their duty. Now, Svenskeren does have Agni's Embrace available. He's hanging around, he wants to make a play, but it's so difficult against the ultimate from Braum, against the rocket jump of Tristana. You are very reliant on Enraged landing a death sentence for that gank to really happen.
And there's pink wards all over the bottom side here for the Wolves. I have to say that one on the backside of the red buff camp has been there for a long time. They do know it's actually there, though. So that should get weeded out. And that one now in Tribush will give the bottom lane some protection. We just want to touch on the CS in the mid lane there, because Soren doing a fantastic job of that so far. Got 20 CS ahead of Jezzus.
Yeah, so one of the reasons that Orianna is so strong at farming is your ability to clear out those Wraith camps very quickly and very safely with your command attack and your command dissonance. And we've actually caught Soren going into SK's Wraith camp to secure that once or twice, as well as taking his own multiple times. So he's doing very well. We're seeing Jezzus not really having too much lane presence. I mean, 20 CS at this stage is the effective value of a kill. And we need to see how he's going to position his CC, how he's going to position his ultimate. Because it is fairly difficult to land. That right of the arcane from Xerath is quite easily dodgeable, and we've seen that multiple times yesterday. One, two of the three shots generally connect, not more.
See that Jezzus building a little bit lopsided here. We see that Athene's was finished for Soren, and Jezzus actually opted for the need to see large rod as they try and get in there. That was a nice little lantern to bring Candy Panda to safety. And we did also have Broken Shot waiting off by the Tribush. They've spotted him now leaving. They're going to hook Unlimited in, but do they have the damage? You see that Candy Panda, very scared, actually flashing away there from the ultimate out of Unlimited. Good calling Wolf Force of Wolves back, though.
So flash burned from Candy Panda to dodge the Glacial Fissure. A lot of spells exchanged, but it's SK Gaming that come away having blown more. They use both of their ultimates and the flash. So if Copenhagen Wolves can take advantage of that the next time their spell reel is available, that's how they can make things work. Just a quick update, you can see that Woolite has not backed in a while. He's still got the pickaxe, the Dorns, and the boots, and he's sitting on 1,800 gold. So realistically, looks like it's going to be an Infinity Edge rush. And it just once again means Candy Panda is going to be stronger sooner. He's got almost enough money for Blade of the Ruined King. And both teams super content to just continue this laning. We may be waiting for the next dragon before we see teams going toe-to-toe, unless somebody gets out of position.
Well, that pickaxe up until now has done decently for Woolite on this bottom side of the map, although he is still slightly behind in CS. However, as you mentioned, that Blade of the Ruined King now is done for Candy Panda, so he's going to come back into the lane, and they'll have to be a little more careful about what they go for. Meanwhile, Svenskeren trying to steal a blue buff. And not going to try, he's going to get it.
Yeah, there's no pressure here from either Broken Shot or Young Buck. And with Young Buck just using his teleport and Freddy having his available, that window of opportunity is available to punish. Svenskeren with another aggressive move. And that was actually blind. If you look at this, there's no vision in Copenhagen Wolves jungle. Sven is just playing this one on gut feeling, and he doesn't get punished for it this time around.
Copenhagen Wolves thinking, damn it, we missed that one. That is not good news. It's going to mean that there's a blue buff there for Evelynn. Blue buff for Xerath, for Jezzus here in just a second as well. If Svenskun helps him out, just getting rid of that ward there. Nice little scan coming down. They're not in any danger of actually losing that one. But as you rightly pointed out, I think Dragon is going to be the next interesting point of this one. That will be coming up in less than 2 minutes' time.
Now, we need to see who's going to get positioned for it, because I do feel the threat of all of those ultimates hitting SK Gaming is a very scary prospect. So SK, if they are going to initiate, or if the Copenhagen Wolves are going to initiate, again, it's going to be very reliant on warding. Dragon play may not be the number one priority because Freddy just teleported top lane. He knew that Youngblood had burned his. Freddy opted to just go back into lane. Cutlass picked up. He's got a Spirit Visage as well to deal with Youngblood and survive some of the MR, some of the magic damage rather. But it's just a farm fest and, you know, season two style. Farm for 20 minutes, then team fight until a winner is found.
Well, I don't think the SK will mind that too much. They've traditionally been very good at that style of game, as we are seeing Svenskun coming in, but Youngbuck spots him early enough and is just able to body slam out of any possible danger there in the top lane. Even will feel confident enough to lay down a bit of pressure underneath the tower itself.
So I wonder if SK are playing so passively out of a fear from anything else. They've got Svenskun, who has been doing individual plays. He's been counter-jungling, he's been trying to shut down Broken Shard single-handedly. And his ganks have been somewhat half-hearted. I mean, SK have been on a downward spiral. They've lost a lot of games in the last few weeks. I think they're 3 wins, 4 losses now. For a team that finished second in the spring split and started quite dominantly earlier on, I wonder how their confidence is doing, you know? How shot is it? Because a lot of the champions are that they were using effectively have sort of fallen out of favor. Jezzes in particular is definitely adding a plethora of new champions to his kit.
Almost getting in there for that big Wraith, which resets just to annoy Jezzes a little bit. But he'll take that one away. Still a good 30 CS behind. And we see now Dragon is up. Both junglers are on the bottom side of that map, and we see that SK, are they just trying
Death
to bait the wolves
start
into this one? There we go, Death Sentence comes in. Unlimited will be pulled back. He will throw down his ultimate, but he may go down here. One more shot should do it. Summoner heal was used. Candy Panda with the Cullen. It's not doing too much damage. Generator almost got away with it. Woolak will in fact survive over the top. There's Seraph ulti coming in. Broken Shard will finish that one off. Well, Broken Shard, will he go down? Shockwave comes in. Summoner heal from Sorin. Keep Broken Shard alive as well. It's a 3-for-1.
And that was some fight that SK Gaming started. They caught Unlimited, and the power of that Glacial Fissure just kept them back for such a long time. Candy Panda and Enrated get squashed under the weight of the Wolves. 1-for-3, and unfortunately, Jezzes once again doesn't land that right of the arcane. Only one of the three shots hit. Take a look at this. This was an engagement that was completely committed to by SK. Unfortunately for Candy Panda, there were some minions blocking the shots of the Culling as well, so not an ideal position for him. But this is the difficulty with Xerath. Yes, you can impact a teamfight from the Dragon, which is great. But if one more of those shots had hit, Broken Shard would have died before the summoner heal was used. It wasn't the case, and the Wolves, they take advantage. They did have the possibility to go Dragon, but everyone was low, and it wasn't worth the risk.
That's going to be surely the next thing on the menu here. We already see Broken Shard moving in towards it. They've got Vision inside of the pit itself as the hook comes out. Doesn't connect to Woolite. And Broken Shard is coming back down here once again. No ulti that was used in the last fight, although that'll be up here pretty soon. It's Cataclysm, not exactly the biggest of cooldowns. It's Candy Panner and Woolite having a trade there. Woolite coming out nicely with that one, but there's the hook. Flay's going to come in, but Enraged's all on his own. Candy Panner doesn't join in, and Woolite will jump away. That means that a couple of guys are low. The Dragon's already gone down there for the Wolves. There's the Shockwave coming on towards Svenskun. Can they finish it off? Cully coming in. There's the Cataclysm down. Actually, Sorin flashing away from it, which means he's still doing damage. He's going to take out Candy Panner as well. Sorin will be picked off there in the end by Jezzes. He's going to try and go for Unlimited as well. Stun active miss, slow does happen, and that is a triple kill for Jezzes on Xerath.
And just like that, SK Gaming turn it around. It's a 2-for-4. This is the Copenhagen Wolves that has been losing so many games. They go for the Dragon without having a bunch of ultimates available. Braum didn't have his ultimate. We didn't see the Cataclysm at the beginning of the Dragon fight. I feel like the Wolves needed to have delayed that one until they had everything to combo together. Shockwave went down once, then Cataclysm. There was nothing from Braum other than his passive. And a very small number of SK members just run circles around the Wolves. In order for the Wolves to win team fights, They need to have their ultimates, they need to stack them effectively, and they cannot afford to get split up. The moment they do, SK's comp is superior. That's why they came away in a better situation.
7-6 up now in kills. Gold is only a 500 difference. In favor still, though, of the Copenhagen Wolves, but we'll see how long they actually hold on to that one, especially since Jezus got that triple kill. That's given him now that Rabadon's death cap on top of his Athene's. Other side, Sorin also has same two big items, but has finished off his Sorcerer's Shoes as well, and we'll see how he continues on that front. In terms of the AD carry build, the Infinity Edge for Warlight was done, got his Zeal for his second item, so headed up probably to that Static Shiv next. Other side, Candy Panda working his way to the Yuma's Ghost Blade.
We'll see how Copenhagen Wolves bounce back from this, because they had a very, very even laning phase. We're actually winning quite handily in that mid lane. Sorin doing a great job on Orianna. And Joe, you were talking about in Picks and Bans how Orianna's doing great. Jezus is dead.
Yeah.
And how great Orianna's are doing here in Europe. 5-1 for the new mid laner. Sorin played Ryze yesterday, was one of the shining lights for Copenhagen Wolves, but it wasn't enough to carry the Wolves against Fnatic. A 5-1 death cap Athenes at 20 minutes on Orianna is definitely a way to win games.
Yeah, those weak solo laners for the Copenhagen Wolves right now. Sorin 5-1, load of CS ahead. Top lane, they're not exactly killing each other, but there's a slight lead there for Youngbuck, and this is a different performance out of him completely when we compare that with yesterday. So SK, no, they're 3-0 up in the head-to-head on this one, but the Wolves, new addition, specifically Sorin in this one, although you could argue as well, Broken Shard has been all over the place.
Yes, he's had a very, very strong late laning phase, because he was bullied early, almost gave up a kill when he was invading red buff. He did die 1v1 against Svenska, but immediately after that, has been moving around effectively. His Cataclysm is going to be very, very important in the next few minutes. But I think Copenhagen Wolves need to make sure they're on the same page. They need to make sure they wait for big objective fights until they have all of their ultimates. They need to wait so that they're stacked up together instead of overcommitting and losing big leads. It's how Copenhagen Wolves have lost so many games in the last 2 or 3 weeks.
On there, getting even more farm out of his jungle. Close to a 50 CS lead at the moment. And if we compare their gold overall, over 10k for Sorin, and Jezus sat on 8.6 at the moment, so that just shows you, considering how close the team global gold is between the two, that farm and those kills for five of them for Sorin really making a difference. And with 2,000 gold to spend, he's going to have more power than Jezus here shortly.
Yeah, and it's in terms of the power, it's interesting to see that Woolite is holding his own with this Tristana Eye Edge against the Blade of the Ring Candy Panda. Every time we see the two sort of trading, Candy Panda generally is coming off worse for wear. Woolite is getting a good combination of damage using that explosive shot well to just keep poking Candy out. And, you know, Tristana is one of those champions that can, in theory, do a whole lot in a team fight. You can argue maybe even more than Lucian in a team fight, thanks to having the Buster shot and thanks to having that incredible range as he continues to get levels. But, as we've talked about, if he doesn't have the support of his whole team, he could get focused out. It's a good stun.
Yeah, stun coming in, Broken Shot slides through, but not going to be able to go any further because of that shot out of Jezus. No gank available for him. Spotting that ward there as well as it went down, so easy clean out with the sweeping lens. Bottom lane, they continue to just farm, as is the case here on the top side of the map. We see Lich Bane and the Rod of Ages, the first two items for Youngbuck. Other side, Freddy really focused on getting that early Blade of the Ruined King.
Okay, so a minute to go before Dragon. Copenhagen Wolves have made better calls at starting Dragon. You can argue the effectiveness of when they should have done it, because they didn't have the ultimates for the second one. This time round, SK have got a higher number advantage. They've also got Freddy, who's getting tankier. He's got his Ninja Tabi completed and the Blade of the Rune King, so there's a damage threat. And I think they may be the ones wanting to jump in the Dragon Pit. You can see how quickly Jezus is forced to flash away, because he's scared of the teamfight power of the Wolves.
See as well that the weak point of Xerath and why a lot of people were scared of picking him before, despite the fact that he can do a lot over massive range if you get caught out. Meanwhile, Freddy here is in no man's land, and Woolite going to come in, and that is an easy kill, and you don't want to be giving this Tristana kills. It's going to get away. She needs to be a lot faster. We see already that static shift was done. Woolite now going to be feeling very, very confident. As they come to mid, are they going to get involved? Doesn't look like it.
Well, one of the problems for SK is they are reliant on Freddy and Svenskeren flanking, coming from the side lanes and trying to impact Copenhagen Wolves that way. In order for that to work, SK really need to step up their vision game. They've started placing some wards in the last minute or two, but there's simply not enough on the map for Freddy to be pushing that deep, as well as SK to, you know, pick smart fights. Now they are trying to rush Dragon. Copenhagen Wolves are grouped up, but they may be here a tiny bit late. There goes Broken Shard.
Oh, they're going to go straight towards Jezus. Cataclysm comes out. Jezus getting blown to pieces there, but Broken Shard himself before. Look at Woolite though in the back. He's absolutely ripping him a new one. And that will be three men down here for SK Gaming. They didn't finish the Dragon either. We see Svenskeren having to get away as well with his flash. And that is going to be killed. And surely a Dragon, actually, they're not going to go for it. I think they're just going to push that inner tower in mid.
Four members of the Wolves, as well as a low health Woolite, just moving themselves in. Teleport was cancelled by Freddy because by the time he wanted to join the fight, it was over. SK got decimated 1-4-3 at the end of the day. And Copenhagen Wolves get the inner turret, decide to back away from Dragon. They were low on HP. Tower is more important than that Dragon. Take a look at this replay again. Copenhagen will stack themselves up very well. Look at the Cataclysm as well as the Glacial Fissure. There is so much area of effect CC that SK simply cannot fight because there's a slow and a wall blocking their way. That was a perfect example of the strengths of the Copenhagen Wolves composition. I would dare say leaving the Dragon up and waiting for the ultimates to come off cooldown before challenging again is actually very smart, because it may force SK to re-challenge, and Copenhagen Wolves, they can just do that same team fight over again. Wait for your ultis to be up, and then go back to the same area because you are very strong in those spaces.
And Woolite, we saw pretty much unchecked at the back. Candy Panda actually did try to get onto Woolite, but that meant that he was just in the middle of the entire team. And when you got the, you know, Sorin's AoE damage, I think specifically in that kind of area, you just can't avoid it. They could lock him down. And the Wolves now moving with four men towards Dragon. Top laners' TPs are both on cooldown. Not going to be able to get involved. That Dragon is going down before SK can get anywhere near it. There's Broken Shot diving in once again. Where's he going to go? It looks like they're going to try and pick off Jezus. Woolite, that's not a hard task for him. He'll get that kill easily. Meanwhile, down in the middle here, they're going to focus on towards Svenskeren. He gets finished off. It's a double for Woolite. May even be a triple here. It will be a triple. He gets the jump now to mid lane. Can they catch up with Candy Panda? Do they even need to? They can push up the mid.
Yeah, they can push up the mid. We talked about how Copenhagen Wolves could just do the exact same scenario, and they did it perfectly. Not only did they use their team fight comp to team fight perfectly, they had it in the exact same area. All of the kills secured in their previous fight landed on Woolite. He's got a BF sword. Copenhagen Wolves got the Dragon. Two back-to-back team fights, a bunch of kills, and the Baron. They are in absolute control of this game. And if SK want to stand a chance, they have to play the map, because right now, they cannot stand toe-to-toe with the Wolves.
What a turnaround here for the Copenhagen Wolves. Look at that. That's 3,300 gold for Youngbuck to actually spend when he decides he fancies going home. He's ahead by about 10 CS in that top lane. We look down some other items as well. Void Staff was picked up before that fight by Sorin. He's now got another needlessly large rod in. There's a Bloodthirster on Woolite, so it's going to be life stealing back. Got that shield to offer him the extra protection as well.
It's just such great play from the Wolves. They made smart decisions yesterday, and what cost them was individual mistakes. Youngbuck gave up far too many kills far too early in the game, and that allowed the hypercarrier Fnatic to just carry them to victory. Now, Youngbuck has yet to die this matchup. He's farming very, very well, averaging 10 CS per minute in that top lane where he's been living on the island, along with Freddy, is a strong performance. And you've seen how effective his teleports have been, in contrast to how terrible Freddy's have been.
Wow.
Wham, bam.
That's not good news. Youngblood going down there, gets the kill, and the Copenhagen Wolves with four, I can't count, pushing this top lane out, and I don't think that Freddy and Jezus can really hang around. Jezus getting caught out. Shockwave will blow up Svenska in here. Jezus is doing some good damage from the back, but Woolite's on him, and you're not getting away from that one. He's going to go under the tower here. Freddy is going to go down. It's a double for Broken Charge. They can just win here.
I think they can if they want to tank up the Nexus turret. It's at 28 minutes. Copenhagen Wolves just pull SK Gaming apart. They're on the Nexus turret. Unlimited has got so much hit points. They're going for the finish.
No problem. They'll tank this one up. Enraten as a Thresh is not going to be able to stop this game falling away from them. Candy Panda going to come up too late. And the Copenhagen Wolves take down SK Gaming in under half an hour.
Fantastic performance from the Wolves. And while it's great that the Wolves have picked this win up, the first victory of the summer split, well, it's the first time we're going to be hearing the howls from Sora Broken Shard. I think that SK are absolutely distraught. They looked out of it. They had a good landing phase, but there was very little interaction between the respective lanes. Sven Skeren was not on the same page multiple times when he was trying to gank. In team fights, they just got completely controlled. They should never have been going toe-to-toe with that very heavy team fight comp of the Wolves.
There are things that I just don't understand about it as well, because we saw in that pre-game video, their solo laners are weaker than us. Why wasn't there then more focus put on getting those solo laners on their side ahead and hindering the progress of Sorin, who finished 7-1-6, of Youngbok, who finished 2-0-3 with almost 300 CS? You know, we heard them say that the last three games, the Copenhagen Wolves have come out with crazy strats against us and we've beat them. If they come and play a standard game, which is what they did here,
yep,
they have more of a chance. SK knew that this was going to happen, that this could happen, so then they did nothing.
It doesn't get more standard than this matchup. We had a full 15 minutes of laning straight toe-to-toe. Very, very little happened. And I think SK Gaming didn't do anything. Sven was trying to counter jungle. He was the most aggressive on his squad, and rated also trying to set plays up. But the first fight that they pick in that bottom lane goes horribly wrong. They end up losing three members for one. They overcommitted to an engage, and it was a bad call. I think individually, SK have moments of brilliance, but they are definitely lacking, and I think there's a mindset shift that needs to happen. Fnatic in the spring split lost 8 games back to back to back, and you could accredit that to them winning so many games early, and then their mindset, you know, practice and training, and it wasn't in the right place. It feels like SK is doing the same because they used to be so tactically smart. They used to be able to make the right decisions. And right now, those dragon fights, back-to-back dragon fights, were terrible.
And you have to say it as well, while Fnatic, we always give them praise, peaking at the right time.
Yeah.
SK Gaming are falling by the wayside at exactly the wrong time coming towards the end. Something needs to change, that's for sure. But for now, we're going to send it over to Shox to hear from Copenhagen Wolves as Youngbok.
Thank you very much, Joe. I'm Ify Shogsupurtra, joined here by Youngbok after that victory versus SK Gaming. Joey, what a difference in the game yesterday versus Fnatic. Talk me through how you guys tackled this, because you guys are superior in the team fights.
Yeah, I think starting from Champions Select, we got everything we wanted. We didn't expect to get such a good Champions Select, so we were very happy with that. And especially them not lane swapping was very good for us, because we definitely lacked communication yesterday when it came to that.
Yeah, I don't want to go too far into that loss yesterday. So let's talk about the status of the team, because two new people coming in here. Maybe some question marks as to where Arak specifically was replaced, because he wasn't doing all that bad. Talk me through why these changes came.
Well, Arak is a very good player and a very good friend, and he's still close with the team. We just talked with each other and said, okay, we have 8 weeks until relegations, and it's very likely that we'll end in seventh place. So if we want to try something now, then we have to do it right now and try to build a team in the next 8 weeks or so. And Broken Shard communicates a lot, and with Kautart falling away from the lineup, we needed someone that communicates a lot, so that's why we're trying out Broken Shard right now.
All right, so you say it's only a tryout, so what is the report card for the two new guys in these first two games?
Well, I'm very happy with both of them. They have played very well, and especially Broken Shard has done exactly what we expected of him.
Good to hear. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
All right, we got to round up some more minions, but we'll be back in 3.5 to break down this game. And then the LCS action continues with Millennium versus Rocket. Stay put.
Just a small town girl.
No.
Living in a lonely world.
We're going to discuss Warlike will in fact survive over the top. There's Serenity coming in. Broken Shard will finish that one off. Well, Broken Shard, will he go down? Shockwave comes in. Someone heal from Soren.
We can fight. Disrupt them.
All 30 seconds.
I'm gonna ulti. Get Zeran. Trash.
And raid it, and raid it, and raid it, and raid it, and raid it. Lucian. Kill Lucian. Okay, TP. Shut out. Okay, she's cancelled. Okay, nice. Push mid.
Meanwhile, down in the middle here, they got his focus on towards Svensson. He gets finished off. It's a double for Warlock. May even be a triple here.